Chapter 11, Captain Jim. The sea was never quiet around Treasure Island. The air might be without a breeze, but the great waves would still crash along the shore. They thundered by day and by night. I don't think there is any place on the island where a person would be out of earshot of their noise. It was becoming dark and quite foggy, yet I could still see the Hispaniola clearly. Alongside was one of the smaller boats. Silver was in it. I could always recognize him. The men in the boat were laughing and talking, but it was too far away to be able to hear what they were saying. Soon after, Silver's boat pulled out for the shore. By this time, the sun had gone down, and I went to find Ben Gunn's boat. The white rock where he said he hid it was still a good distance away. Finally, in a hollow by the rock, I saw it. It was homemade. If ever anything were homemade, it had a lopsided frame of tough wood and upon that a covering of goatskin. It was very small, even for me. I guess that it was the worst boat ever made, but for all that, I knew that it would still serve my purpose. With all of the sunlight gone, all that I could see was the fire around which the pirates sat on the shore and a mere blur coming through the foggy air. That blur was the Hispaniola, lighted at the stern window. I had my plan, and it was this. I would slip out and cut the Hispaniola adrift. She would then go wherever the tide might take her. I picked up the small light boat. I put it down on the surface of the water and got in. The little boat was safe for a person of my weight, but it seemed to have a mind of its own. Do as I pleased, it would steer to the right when I wanted to go to the left. Turning round and round was the trick at which it was best. It turned in every direction but the one in which I wanted to go. I saw the faint outline of the Hispaniola. The bowsprit was soon over my head. I sprang to my feet and began pulling myself along onto the deck. I heard not a sound from the ship, and it gave me a strange feeling. I reached the end and swung my feet to the deck. There I found Israel Hands and another sailor. Each was lying with a bottle of rum at his side. I saw splashes of dark blood around them. I felt sure that they had killed each other, but suddenly Israel Hands turned his head and gave a low moan. "Mr. Hands," I say bravely, "I have come aboard to take command. You will regard me as your captain." He struggled to his feet, seeing the guns at my side. He said slyly, "I reckon I've tried my last fling and lost. So I'll help you sail the ship where you want, Captain Hawkins." He looked at me angrily and continued, "You cannot sail the ship if I don't help you. If you tie up my wound, I will help you." "First of all," said I can't have those colors flying. You must fly the Union Jack." I pulled down the pirate flag and strung up the flag of England. "God save the king," I said, waving my cap, "and there's an end to Long John Silver." Hands watched me keenly. I was to take care of his wounds, and he would sail the Hispaniola to the north inlet of Treasure Island. It seemed to me a fair bargain. The next morning, we had the ship underway. The breeze served us well, and we skimmed like a bird. The coast of the island flashed by. The view changed at every moment. I was greatly pleased with my new command and also pleased with the bright sunshine. I had water and things to eat. Everything was going according to my plan. In short, I was happy with the great conquest I had made. However, I was uneasy on board, alone with Hands. His eyes followed me along always as I moved about the deck. There was an odd smile on his face as he took the wheel. He craftily watched and watched and watched me. We were sailing along fine when Hands said to me, "Jim, this brandy's too strong for my head. Be a good lad and run down for some wine." I could tell that this was a trick. No doubt, he wanted to get me off the deck for some reason. Knowing this, I played along. I went down the deck with a great clatter of my feet. Then I took off my shoes and crept back. I saw him take a knife and hide it in his clothes. This was all I needed to know. He now had a weapon. I then ran down to the galley and grabbed a bottle of wine. When I returned, Hands was just where I had left him. He called out orders as nothing had happened. "Now, lad," he said, "look there. That's a fine place to bring a ship into. Stand by, boy. A little more starboard. More steady. A little larboard. Steady, steady, he cried. I was so interested in the way the ship was moving that I quite forgot to watch hands. Perhaps I saw his shadow or heard a creak, but sure enough, when I looked, there was the hands. He was halfway towards me with a knife in his right hand. A savage look on his face. We both cried aloud when our eyes met. While mine was a cry of terror, his was a roar of charging bull. I leaped sideways as quickly as I could. I let go of the tiller that I was holding to steer the Hispaniola. It sprang back sharply and hit hands. He gasped loudly with pain and surprise. The knife he was holding dropped to the deck. It was the tiller that saved my life, for it hit hands with such force that it stopped him instantly. Before he could recover, I ran forward. I was safely out of the corner into which he had trapped me. I had the whole deck to dodge about, but as I turned, I saw that, once more, he was coming after me. I had to think carefully, yet quickly, what my next move would be.